there weren't many people talking about it, or at least it hadn't been something in my life that I knew anything about. So, you know, to return the favor, it was more of like, well, let me be transparent about everything. It's not a secret. I have breast cancer. This is what you need to know about what I'm going through, and hopefully it can help you.
Hello, and welcome to the podcast, Cancer of Love Yourself Story, where we ask hard questions and we have healing conversations. And we explore things like, what if a cancer diagnosis doesn't have to be the end of everything you thought to be true about your life? Rather, what if it's a mindful and a soulful invitation to become the best version of yourself? Well, today I am thrilled to be introducing Leah Vollaro. She is a beautiful young cancer patient, and she's so much more than that, but she's agreed to come on today and share a little bit of her experience with the hope of encouraging other people. She's a 29-year-old from New York who was recently diagnosed with breast cancer in September of 2020, and her husband, Vinny, has been an amazing support throughout her hurdles of her recent diagnosis. To help her through her journey, she finds comfort in her hobbies, and one of those is music. And she's going to share that with us at the end of this podcast. So be sure to tune in for that because it's a treat. I've heard her and she's incredible. If you want to find her, you'll find her on Instagram at So I Have Breast Cancer. She is amazing. So welcome to the show, Leah.
Thank you. Thank you. I'm glad to be here. Thank you for speaking with me. And you've been such an inspiration thus far with everything I've been going through. So thank you.
My goodness, you're absolutely gorgeous. And I, you know, when I look over your social media, my first thought was I have to get her on this show because she's going to inspire so many people. You already are inspiring so many people.
That's nice to say.
Yeah, your brave documentation of your journey and what your experience is. I mean, it's a real and raw look through what this brutal journey can be, for sure.
Absolutely. And you know, a lot of people, we talked before, a lot of people aren't sure if they want to be public about it or you know, how they want to handle it, and that's fine, whatever works for them. But you know, I found that there weren't many people talking about it, or at least it hadn't been something in my life that I knew anything about. So, you know, to return the favor, it was more of like, well, let me be transparent about everything. It's not a secret. I have breast cancer. This is what you need to know about what I'm going through, and hopefully it can help you. So that's how, you know, I saw it with my Instagram page and posting literally everything that's going on.
I think it's incredible. And I appreciate the rawness of it, because I think that we tend to, as cancer patients, we tend to brush things underneath the rug because we don't want people to feel uncomfortable. Like, we don't want our family to feel uncomfortable, or our friends, or the people who care about us. But I do believe that for someone who might be going through this journey, that could be the moment of truth. Like, oh, okay, this is completely normal and I'm experiencing this and it's okay. So I think it can be very life affirming, actually. So
absolutely. Absolutely. You know, it's, it was alarming the amount of people who came to me after I had told them, and they're like, oh, I'm a cancer survivor. I'm a breast cancer survivor. And, you know, everyone has their stories, or they know someone, or they know someone who knows someone. And it's alarming how common it is.
Sure. Sure. So how about if you open up by sharing a little bit about how you got here? Like, what was you're 29 years old. That's too young to be going through this.
Believe me, I feel old. I was 28 going on 60 now, maybe. So, okay. You know, it was just an ordinary day. I was at the office, and clumsy me, I had brushed up against something, and that's really how I discovered the lump. It was sore. I didn't know what was going on. I felt it. And then lo and behold, it was a mass. It was a lump. And I had called the doctor immediately, booked an appointment to get it checked out. They were pretty great with that. And, you know, one thing led to another. We did a breast exam, we did an ultrasound, we did mammogram. Then the next week I had to do a biopsy. So each step was, you know, we're not sure what this is yet. Don't panic. We're going to figure this out. And then ultimately with the biopsy, they concluded that I have invasive a mammary carcinoma, ER positive, HER2 negative. So, whatever that means, but, that's what they had found out. From there, it was just an onslaught of doctors. I wanted to get the best knowledge, the best care. So I was meeting, you know, doctor after doctor just to figure things out. But at that point, I was pretty inundated with just information, and I had to take it some time to slow down. After that, it was, you know, finally I settled on one doctor who I felt very comfortable with. And that's really one of the most important things. You need to find someone that you can trust and you feel comfortable with and that you know they're doing the right thing.
Yeah. Amen on that. And you said you went through several doctors before you landed on one that you were comfortable with. And I try to tell people that all the time. If your team doesn't feel like family, you need to find another team, because this is your very life that you are putting in their hands, and you need to feel that you're going to be heard and that you're going to be informed every step of the way.
Absolutely. 100%. And that I think was the most important thing for me, was to find a safe place, trust them and just know that everything was going to be fine from there. Because if you don't trust your doctors, you know, you're questioning everything, and that can affect so much more too. So, that was really important to me.
Sure. And you need that peace of mind of going, okay, they're professionals, you know, I'm okay in their hands.
Yeah. Yeah. And, you know, I think what it was too was, you know, they were all pretty much saying similar things, and just I think me also being lost in everything, and then, you know, each doctor kind of confirming things and confirming and confirming. Maybe it was me also who began to realize, okay, we're going to settle on this one. She's saying this. I feel comfortable with her. And I think that was something else that tied into it as well.
Sure. And were there little nuances between their recommendations from doctor to doctor?
Yes, absolutely. So, let's see. One of the doctors said they could operate immediately, which was great. Another doctor said I would have to do chemo up front. A couple other doctors after that said the same thing, to shrink it down and kind of be like a test subject and see how the chemotherapy drugs would affect my body and how the tumor itself would react to it. And ultimately that's what we decided to do, was do chemo up front, shrink the tumor down. The tumor itself measures about 4 centimeters, and the doctor I settled on didn't feel comfortable operating on it as it was. So we're doing the chemotherapy up front to see if it shrinks down. If it does, then we can do a lumpectomy. And that's what we're settling on.
Outstanding. And did they give you any kind of staging at this point, or are they waiting for that?
Each doctor said something a little bit different, but the average, I guess you could say, is clinical stage 2 breast cancer.
Okay. All right. And I had kind of a different experience from you. My surgery was first, and then chemo and radiation came after that. Mm-hmm. But there are different, and I just mentioned that because there are different approaches, and yours is very popular. A lot of times they want to be they want to be sure that chemo is going to be doing its job. And so they'll do that to shrink the tumor, and then they'll operate after that.
Absolutely. And it's not only just to shrink the tumor. If there's any cancer that has spread that they can't pick up or trace, it will attack that as well.
Yeah. Outstanding. Yeah. So did you, and I know that a lot of cancer patients aren't aware that there are choices to make. I mean, there are recommendations that come from the doctor according to the guidelines and standards and protocol, but there are some choices that you get to make. For me, I chose a bilateral mastectomy. Some people choose a lumpectomy. Some people choose a single mastectomy. And so kind of where are you at in that thought process?
You know what? I was so lost in the decisions because, you know, it's such a huge decision. And for a doctor to say it's your choice, it's like, what? What do you mean it's my choice? Can you tell me what to do? So, you know, I struggled with it for maybe a couple of months. You know, what was I going to do? Was I, you know, my initial reaction was, all right, I don't want to worry about this. I don't want to keep going back to the doctor and having an anxiety attack about if I have cancer again. Let's do a mastectomy. You know what? Let's throw them both in. Let's do a bilateral mastectomy. It's fine. There's plastic surgery. It's okay. Everything will be fine. And the more and more I thought about it, it was like, why am I choosing to essentially take off parts of my body if I don't have to? And I came to that conclusion because a couple of the doctors actually said this. And again, it's your choice and what you're comfortable with. And that's really the root of how you heal yourself, I believe. But one of the doctors had said, you know, it's very unlikely for the cancer to reoccur in the same place. What will happen is it might spread to your blood. It might spread to your brain somewhere else. And it's still breast cancer that's spread there, but it's not going to be in your breasts, or the likelihood was slim to none. And I was, you know, I thought about that and I was like, well, why would I go through a very intensive surgery if I didn't have to? And that was my thought process, which was a whole completely 360 from what I thought, like in the beginning. I was like, all right, chop them off. It's fine. It's good. So, you know, it's just being put through that choice was just so hard. You know, it's not just, this is what you can do. This is how you're going to heal yourself. It's up to you. You know, I spoke to a lot of different people about what their choices were and why. And it was really great to hear their stories. And really I took bits and pieces from that. And it was like, all right, well, do I want to do the, you know, the long-term healing or short-term and just annual checkups? It was a lot to think about. So, again, ultimately we decided on trying the chemo first, lumpectomy. And again, if it doesn't work per se, like if the tumor doesn't shrink as we want it to, or if it comes in little bits and pieces, we might have to do a mastectomy as well, which is something I'm still comfortable with. But if I don't have to, I'm not going to.
Oh, I'm with you. I think that's an outstanding decision. And I know that you even on your social media, you were asking people what their experiences were, and you had the gamut of all of the experiences. And even that information can be overwhelming. Everybody wants to give you advice and, you know, offer things up. But your approach, I think in the end, is a very conservative approach, right? I mean, you can always do something bigger, but you don't have to start there. And especially I'm thinking that your doctors probably said at your age, you have youth on your side, which somebody had to have said that to you before me, right?
They did.
Yes. And so your chances of healing are exponentially better than someone who might be older than you and someone who's at a different stage of life. Mm-hmm. So I think you have all of those things going for you, which is beautiful. And you still have your eyebrows, which are beautiful. I'm so jealous.
They're penciled in a little bit, but
I love it. When I went bald, I missed my eyebrows the most because, you know, how do you tell if you're surprised? I had to rely on my wrinkles because my eyebrows weren't there to do the talking.
It's so funny, the things that we don't think about with in regards to that, but yes, I still have my eyebrows.
Yes. So how many chemo treatments do you have on deck?
So total, we're going to do 8. I will be doing my third one this upcoming Friday, so in a couple days, really. So 8 sessions up front, and then we'll see if I have to do radiation or chemo afterwards. We won't know until the actual surgery.
And you're still working through all of this too, right?
Yes. Yeah. You know what? I have to keep busy. I'm just that kind of a person. I mean, I can play my music, draw, read, whatever at home, but if I can leave the house and go to work or do work from home, I'm going to. If I stop, I start to dwell on things. Mm-hmm. And, you know, yeah. I like keeping busy, especially through being diagnosed with cancer and everything that's going on.
No, I'm with you. So if I can be so bold as to ask you right now, what are you missing the most?
steak. Steak and sushi. I mean, I knew that was gonna happen. And the reason for that is, well, I shouldn't be eating it as much anyways, but with a compromised immune system now, you know, bacteria, all of that, something that I didn't even think about. You know, I have to be mindful of everything that I intake into my body. And of course I slip up every now and then, but, it's definitely steak and sushi for me.
Nice. Nice. And have there been any, big surprises, that you know, things you didn't think would be happening, but now you're kind of adjusting to this new sense of normal?
The surprise to me is, I guess, a positive surprise. I'm surprised that, you know, I'm able to function, really. You know, I'm going to work. I'm able to do almost everything. Just the few days after chemotherapy, they hit the hardest. And essentially after like those 3 to 4 days, I'm knocked out and then I can go back and resume my normal life. So that's, I think, what surprises me the most about the whole process is that I am able to do things.
Yeah, you're still a badass. So that's awesome.
Thanks.
And something I want the audience to know about, and Leah has agreed to share it with us, is that because of your age, you had an additional choice to make when it came to fertility. Because you're still thinking about potentially maybe having a family, and you know, you didn't want to be robbed of that option just because of treatment. So can you walk us through your journey and what you decided about in the fertility treatment?
Yes, absolutely. It was an option I didn't even think about. And to be honest, you know, my husband and I, we've spoken about it, if we want children or not. And for me and for us, it was, you know, if it happens, it happens. If it doesn't, that's okay too. We enjoy each other. That's fine. But now with a cancer diagnosis and going through chemotherapy and it potentially knocking out my reproductive system, it was something that we had to think about. And, you know, I liked how you said that, you know, robbed of, you know, the potential to have a family. And I didn't want to, you know, have that choice eliminated. I love the power of choice, you know, even though it sometimes, you know, it's a struggle between lumpectomy or mastectomy, but, you know, to have that potentially taken away from me, you know, even if we didn't decide yet, it was something that I didn't want taken away from me. So, having fertility treatment, was an option I didn't think about and an option I ultimately chose. So I met with the fertility doctors. They were absolutely great. They, you know, it was just, I wasn't even sure what to think of it. It was just going through the motions and everyone was just so great about it.
So is this pre-chemo?
Pre-chemo. Yeah. Okay. So I had to do all of this before chemotherapy, before, you know, it might affect my reproductive system and my body in general. So before chemo, it was essentially I had to inject medications into my pelvic region to stimulate my ovaries, to grow my follicles, which essentially hold the eggs in your ovaries, to a good amount of size. So you're bloated for a while, you know, as it progresses. And it was so cool just to see the ultrasound of everything going on inside. And it was just so amazing to see. And I was so glad that I was doing it just to learn about my body, learn about what I could handle and whatnot. It was amazing. It was incredible. So essentially, the goal was to extract about 10 to 15 eggs from me. And then after that, they would clean them up and see what they could salvage. So the goal really was to have 10 eggs at the end of everything. So throughout the process of me injecting everything, and then afterwards, it was a surgery. It was a quick surgery. It was like 10 minutes maybe. And they put you under. They extracted 18 or 19 eggs from me, and they were able to save, I believe, 16, which was amazing because now I have so many options, and just to have the choice and potential to have a family, that was great. So I'm really glad that I did that.
So how does that work at the end of your treatment? I'm assuming that for a period of time, your cycles will stop. And then they should resume. And then if you wanted to use the eggs at any point, I guess you could, you know, investigate other ways to use your eggs as well. What do you think will be happening at the end?
So by the end of my treatment, a couple of the oncologists that I've met with, they said, you know, since I'm ER positive, since my tumor itself is susceptible to hormones, I will be put on medically induced menopause for up to 5 years. They wanted 5 years. The fertility doctor was like, well, it could be 2 or 3. Don't tell them I said that. I was like, well, I want to do the thing that's right for me. But I will be under medically induced menopause. So after that is when I will be able to potentially have children.
Oh, that's incredible. Mm-hmm. And I'm so glad to that we can say this out loud so that other people can have that hope as well.
Yeah, you know, that's the main point of me having this conversation with you too, is just to make people aware of the different choices that are out there. And that I loved what you said in the beginning, you know, that it's not a cancer diagnosis isn't the end of the things that you wanted. It could be potentially the beginning.
Yes, absolutely. I want to get that message out to as many people as possible.
Yes.
And you are definitely a ray of sunshine. So I know that people are going to love this interview. I'm so excited. You know, something that we talked about briefly in our conversation after this. So not only are you undergoing cancer treatment, but you and your husband both had COVID.
We did.
Oh my goodness. So what was that like?
So it affected both of us differently. And, you know, after I had been diagnosed with cancer, it was just the whole stress of, oh my gosh, there's a global pandemic going on and I have a weakened immune system. So I'm like, okay, well, first of all, I wanted to be careful. I want to be healthy and I want to do the things that are right for everyone, but I didn't want to stop my life either. So, you know, I wear my mask, I use hand sanitizer, we go here and there, but wherever we slipped up and we both got COVID.
And you're in New York, which was at one time the epicenter, right?
It was. Yeah. So for the most part, everyone's, you know, wearing their mask, using hand sanitizer, staying 6 feet away. And I'm not really putting myself in danger, but again, you can get it from anything. You can get it from someone who's asymptomatic. You can get it from, I don't know, it's on a surface somewhere and you touch it and you don't wash your hands by accident. So whatever it was, we got it. And it affected us completely different. I was worried because I have a weakened immune system. I was thinking, oh my gosh, okay, this is going to be bad. Let's stay home forever. But it was the opposite for me and it was worse for him, where it's for me, it was like a common cold. I got over it. You know, my symptoms weren't that bad. It was maybe fatigued for a little bit. I lost my sense of smell for 2 or 3 days. It came back. That was essentially, I had a slight cough. But my husband, you know, it knocked him out. It was bad. It was, you know, I feel like the worst he's been since we've been together for 8 or 9 years or so. And so after that, towards the end, he couldn't breathe. One of his cousins actually suggested for him to get, I forget what it's called, a pulse oximeter. Perfect. So, we got that and he was measuring, you know, how much oxygen was in his blood because he was having trouble breathing. It was low. So, you know, the cousin thought that he should go to the hospital that night and he didn't want to. I'm like, okay, well, I'll bring you in the morning. So we brought him to the hospital in the morning and found out, you know, he's okay. He just has pneumonia now. So that's another additional thing on top of that. And, you know, I just feel terrible because I took it fine. I'm fine. And he's, you know, he's still fatigued. Even now he's not feeling well. So, You know, you have to be careful in, you know, without getting too opinionated on here. You know, a lot of people think, you know, it's fine, I'll get it, I'll get over it, but you don't know who you're going to infect, and that other person might not be able to handle it the way that you think you can, or the way that you've seen other people. And for example, I know that I think I contracted it first and gave it to my husband, and you know, that's just something that had happened.
And you're welcome.
So we're still battling.
Welcome to be as opinionated as you'd like to be on here, by the way. You don't have to hold back on my account. But I do, you know, that's a huge concern. Now you're both the patient and the caregiver, I'm sure, right? And, you know, that delicate balance, I'm sure you're feeling like, what a horrible time to be getting all of this and have to be dealing with this.
It's funny, my husband was very public about it on his social media on Facebook about the COVID. And I was just, one of his posts was, it was something about, you know, we're battling breast cancer and just got over COVID. What else is next? Bring it. And I'm like, no, please.
No. Take that back.
Yeah.
Oh my goodness.
So it was funny.
Wow. That's a lot.
You know, I am a big believer in you don't get anything that you can't handle or however the saying goes, but you know, the things that happen to you are things that happen because the cosmos or whoever, you know, thinks that you can handle whatever you're going through.
Well, you must be very strong. I didn't want all that. I'm like, oh yeah. So
I don't want it either, but I can't do anything about it.
I'd like to be under the radar for just a little bit. That'd be nice. Right?
Absolutely.
So how is cancer treatment currently in a COVID environment? From what I understand, there's a lot of isolation that happens as you're going through treatment. Can you walk us through what that looks like?
Yeah. So in general, right now, I had one chemo treatment before I got COVID, so I was able to see what, you know, the scenario was for normal during pandemic was. And you know, it is very isolated in general when you go in. For the first time I went, I was in like a little suite. It was all closed off and you know, masks and everything. But then when I had the second chemo treatment, was when I had COVID, or, you know, the 10 days after I had COVID. And I had to go through a separate area. I could not touch anything, which was great. So all the doors were being opened for me, but, the nurse had to, you know, dress in a whole PPE gown, like triple, quadruple masks, I think she had on. But the thing was that nurse couldn't treat anyone else that day just to be sure that she was fine after treating someone who had COVID. And you know, the symptoms weren't being shown. So I was allowed to go back in because I wasn't showing symptoms. And it was after the time that I was released by the health department after my quarantine, but still, there were extra precautions just because there's so many people with weakened immune systems and you have to be careful there, but they don't want to stop, or if you don't want to stop, they won't make you stop your chemo treatment. So, you know, it was very isolated. I think they brought me in on a Saturday when no one was there, which was cool too. But, you know, you're just put in a room with one person and that was it.
From what I'm hearing from some of the groups that I belong to, people are not able to get their reconstruction done all the time. Some people are having to delay their treatments. Some things are happening as a result of our COVID environment today. And I'm always worried about our friends that are going through that. I want them to get the best treatment possible, but I don't think that people who are not wearing masks realize that this has the propensity to go well beyond you. You know, we are looking at our sisters and brothers that may not be getting treatment as a result of it, or may not be able to complete their treatment or their reconstruction. And so I think those things are worth mentioning as just an incentive for people to be doing the right thing.
Absolutely, 100%. You just reminded me too. I work in health insurance, and I meet with a lot of people in Medicare and a lot of people who are undergoing cancer treatment. And that's my clientele. And I've had a number of clients who passed away this past year due to not being able to go to get their treatments or being scared to go out. And it's really, sorry, it's really sad. It's very sad.
It is sad.
So you reminded me, yeah, that, you know, you have to be careful. You don't know who you're going to infect, and the recklessness of everyone, it terrifies the older generation to not go get their cancer treatment, and now they died of cancer. You know, it's very sad. It's very sad.
And that's an excellent point, because I just spoke with a physicist and radiation oncologist therapist in Ontario. She said that their census is down approximately 30% for no other reason than people are afraid to get out of their houses and seek treatment, right? Not because it's more dangerous to go anywhere, not because of, you know, they're not willing to safeguard, nothing like that, but they're trying to wait it out. And so I want to make sure that we're saying out loud to people, do not wait to get help, right? When Absolutely. You see something that's wrong, go get it checked out, please. We cannot afford
Absolutely.
To. Yeah. So, yeah, that was a brilliant conversation. Thank you. So, you know, of course, I'm dying to know a little bit more about you and Vinny, and how this affects you and your relationship, and how that feels as a caregiver. Is that something he might want to weigh in on?
Absolutely. I could actually go grab him, and I know we speak about it all the time, so I'm sure he'd love to share with us.
Hey, you can bring your puppy too.
I actually am.
Good.
Because like he's gonna start barking if we don't. So this is my husband Vinny.
Hello.
This way. You're not even in it.
Oh. You're gonna have to squish together. Hi Vinny, how are you?
Hi, how are you?
Oh, it's so nice to meet you. All right, Vinny, thank you so much for joining us today. And oh wait, where's the puppy dog? I got to see the puppy
He's
dog.
He's right here.
And what his her name?
His it's Pepe.
Pepe? Oh my gosh, he's so cute. I see him in some of your media, and I know the puppies are such good comfort when you're in the middle of all of this.
He really is. He's been so good. He always, I mean, he's a little bit of a nuisance, but he's always checking up on me.
Yeah. I think he's hungry.
Yeah, we'll get him there in a second. So Vinny, I know that this is quite the journey to go through as a couple. And I was wondering if you could share a few things with our audience about how you experience this as a couple, and like, what are your typical areas of support as Leah's going through this?
Well, just you have to be there when, you know, just being there is half the battle. Like I just went through COVID. I definitely could not have done it without Leah. She, thank God, got a milder case than I did. and, you know, and now we were over the COVID. Now we're back to dealing with the cancer. And I just, whatever she needs, you know.
That's really the main thing too. You know, a lot of people ask me, what can I do for you? What can I do for you? And the most important thing is just being there. I don't need anything. I mean, I'm pretty independent, but
yeah,
just for someone to be there or be around, or if I, you know, just around if God forbid I do need anything. So, you know, Vinny's been driving me to my chemo sessions. Yeah, she won't let me drive, and I shouldn't be driving anyways, but he's just been amazing just being here for me.
Oh, yeah, great. I really don't feel like I'm doing anything special. I feel kind of useless sometimes, but it's really just like Leah said, I drive her to the chemo, I wait, you know, because of COVID rules, you're not allowed to go inside and wait. So just be there when she gets out. And if she feels like eating, then we eat. If she doesn't feel like eating, we don't eat. And then we just get back home. And, you know, she's basically upstairs, and she doesn't want me to come in every 2 seconds. Can I get you anything? Can I get you anything? So I basically, you know, I just wait downstairs until I'm needed. So
that's amazing. Really, it's just bring me a ginger ale, please.
Yeah. That's it. make me some tea, bring me a ginger ale. I have gone through this with my mother and father. You know, it's a little different when it's your wife, obviously. Sure. But, you know, I kind of know what to expect. But it's been a while, though, since my mother and father. So thank God medicine is different now, and, you know, modern medicine, and a lot of breakthroughs since my mother had breast cancer.
So. Sure. Oh, thank goodness. We're so much better than we used to be for that.
Yeah.
So I'm going to put you on the spot, Vinny, that's okay. I would love for you to tell me three words that you feel describes Leah.
Strong, independent, and, well, self-sufficient is two words, but she's had such a great outlook throughout this whole thing, like sharing her experience on Instagram and just letting other people know what's going on. And hopefully someone can learn from what she's going through.
I love her transparency, and I appreciate that so very, very much. I know that other people do too. And if you, either one of you, want to answer this, what do you think the number one, now, Leah, you just talked about somebody just being there. What does that mean to you? Like, if somebody wants, people always want to do something and they feel helpless, right? Because they love you, they want the best for you. What do you consider to be being there? Like, what does that look like?
Just to me, honestly, it's just being available. And one of the biggest things for me is not treating me like I have cancer. I am very, very well aware that I have cancer. I don't need to be told. Yeah. So just having a normal conversation with me, or, you know, I mean, it's different with COVID and a pandemic, but in normal times, it would just be having coffee with me, or just doing normal things. It's hard to say what is being there. But for Vinny, it's literally just being in the same room with me, or in the house, or being available if I need to talk about something or anything. He's always there.
That's beautiful. And Vinny, if you were going to give some advice to caregivers, to other caregivers that are in your situation, what would you offer up to them today?
Well, it's I don't even know if I can give advice. It's just, it's a day by day thing, and we play it by ear. And like I said, I'm just here. If she needs something, I'm here. I'm not going to leave the house, and, you know, unless I know she's okay. With the COVID atmosphere and telecommuting, it's almost fortunate that I can be home now. So that is a blessing in disguise. We're both working our way back into going back to work now. But we know the chemo's coming up every other week, and we're going to deal with it as it comes up every other week. You know, we'll change our lives around a little for 3 or 4 days.
Sure. Yeah. Right. And that's important to note, right? Chemo really levels you, but not forever, just for a little while. And then you get to pop back. Right.
Exactly.
I noticed I was on like a 4-day cycle, I think, when I was going through cancer treatment.
Yeah.
My first one, and I didn't know what to expect. My first one was like 2 or 3 days. I was fine. The last one was about 4 or 5 days. And, I'm expecting it to get increasingly difficult to say. So, it's just, you know, each time is different for me right now.
So 2 down, 6 to go.
Yes.
And then will they rescan you at that time?
I'm not really sure. After the surgery, I think they'll just reassess everything. I probably have to do an MRI, but I'm not entirely sure.
Okay. All right. So for either one of you, what do you feel like the biggest lessons that you have learned so far? I know you're very early in your journey, but you've been through an awful lot in the last few months. Like, what would you think are your biggest takeaways, or your biggest lessons so far?
For me, it's, I've kind of viewed this as a blessing for me to slow down, because I was just always on the go a lot with my career, just appointments after appointments and catering to everyone else. And I wasn't able to slow down and my body said, well, you have cancer now, you have to slow down. So I've been taking it as this is my time to spend time for myself and explore things that I want to do, or just my hobbies. as Vinny said, this is actually the room that I spend my time in right after chemotherapy, because it's just like, it's a separate room. And I have my piano here, I have my desk. If I want to do work, I can draw, I can do art. So it's been a forced pause for me to do the things I want.
Oh, brilliant. I couldn't agree more. And what about you, Vinny? What
I actually think, I think she thinks she's slowed down, but I think she goes, I think she goes back to work too soon after the chemo. Like, she's, you could tell she doesn't feel well, but she's going out to appointments. And I'm like, what are you doing? You know, they're going to understand. Take a break.
You know? Oh, man, the secret's out, Leah.
I thought I was saying it. Well, I'm not seeing as many people. I mean, I do a lot of Zooms from my office. I thought I slowed
I remember my mother just being so wiped out from radiation and chemo that, you know, months at a time, she just wasn't leaving the house, and except to go to a chemo appointment or a radiation appointment.
Sure.
And then I see Leah after day three, like, yeah, I'm going to an appointment. I'm like, okay. It's like, you know, that's where you don't really, you don't intervene. You just, and you don't judge. You just say, okay.
You just observe, right?
Yeah, that's the thing too, because another thing I want to say is the person who's going through whatever they're going through, for me, it's cancer and chemotherapy right now. I know what I can handle. I know my limits. So for example, if I'm going out to an appointment, if I don't feel well, I might cancel that appointment. I might apologize, reschedule. I might cut it short, or I might just not have as strenuous as an appointment as I usually do. So I know my limits, and I think that's a very important point for other people going through the same thing, or people who are around people who have been diagnosed with cancer. Usually that person knows their limits and they won't push themselves.
Sure. And it's the intersection of compassion and grace, right? I mean, you've got to be compassionate with yourself. Like, man, I can't do this today. And it's okay if I can't do this today. I'm going to hang back and binge watch a TV show, and it's all good, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. So only you know when you're good to push yourself or good to pull back. And that's a brilliant point. You know, rest when you need to, take naps when you need to. I love naps now. And I, you know, I mean, like, I never needed them before, but
yeah.
I love a good nap now. And so, yeah, that's a best practice that I picked up along the way. So yeah, absolutely.
Well, and I know my opinion on that would be futile anyway. I think
right. So, oh my gosh,
a big part of it is knowing when to shut up also, so.
Brilliant. Oh my gosh, that's great, Vinny.
He's great at it though.
Oh my goodness, I so appreciate you both being on here, and I would love to now, I want to make some space for you to share your beautiful musical talent with us.
Oh, okay.
And
I think she means you. I'll take Peppy downstairs and feed him.
Okay.
All right. Thank you.
Oh, thank you, Vinny. I so appreciate you being on here.
Okay.
Oh, now I've asked Leah to share something very personal and incredibly beautiful. When I was stalking her on her personal account on Instagram, I saw that she sang one of my very favorite songs, and she has agreed to share that with you as a way of providing hope and inspiration and just a little bit of herself. And so she's going to sing the song Hallelujah for us today.
Okay, this is also one of my favorite songs too, by Leonard Cohen. Well, I've heard there was a secret chord that David played, and it pleased the Lord. But you don't really care for music, do ya? Well, it goes like this: the fourth, the fifth, the minor fall, and the major lift, the baffled key composing Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
faith was strong, but you needed proof. You saw her bathing on the roof, her beauty in the moonlight overthrew you. While she tied you to her kitchen chair, she broke your throat and she cut your hair. From your lips she drew the hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. Baby, here before, I've seen this room and I've walked this floor. I used to live alone before I knew ya. Well, I see your flag on the marble arch. Love is not a victory march, it's a cold, it's a broken hallelujah. Hallelujah. Hallelujah,
yeah, that was so beautiful.
Oh, thank you
so much.
I love that song.
thank you for sharing that part
absolutely
of yourself. So beautiful inside and out, and I know this conversation is going to help people today, and so I so very much appreciate you, and I will be looking at your media. And tell everybody where they can find you.
Okay, so you can find me at on Instagram at So I Have Breast Cancer, and that's where you can find everything I post about my journey through breast cancer, the struggles, the hurdles, the positives, the nitty gritty, everything. And if anyone has any questions, you can message me there as well, and I'd be glad to speak with you.
Beautiful, Beautiful. And for the people in the audience, if you want to find me, you can find me at Day of the Warrior on Facebook and Instagram. And that's Daye, Day of the Warrior. And I also have this amazing podcast where I get to host incredible people like Leah. And I cannot wait to have the next conversation. Thank you, Leah.
Thank you. Thank you for having me.